Hello and welcome to NewsX Sunday Garden Roundtable on the economy. Well, BJP leader Subramanian Swamy has recently sounded the alarm bell when he said that the Indian economy is in a tailspin and it could even lead to depression if corrective measures are not being taken. In response, the finance minister has said that corrective measures are being planned and will be taken. What these are, he will let us know soon. To discuss this with me, I have a panel of experts. Joining me is Rajiv Chandrasekhar from the NDA, Mr. KTS Tulsi from the UPA, we have Jay Panda from the BJD, and of course, Dr. Subramanian Swamy himself. Dr. Swamy, I'll begin with you. You know, you actually said that according the things are even worse than what they appear, because according to the Samuelson Swamy theory of index numbers, it's not even 5.7%, but right. Lower than that.
Yeah, see, let me put it as simply as possible. When you calculate growth rates, you have to have constant prices. Otherwise, the inflation will be into it and you will get a wrong idea. If you want the, since there are so many commodities of different kinds, and there, some is in liters, somebody is in kilogram, somebody is in mons, you know. So earlier on, till we came to power, the base was 2003-04, that is April to March. Now, what Mr. Jaitley's ministry did after we came to power is shifted it to 2013-14. Now, 2013-14 prices are much higher. So, when you calculate these later years prices, the figures are larger. If you today take the UPA growth rates and recalculate it on to 2013-14, then you will get a higher growth rate than the UPA itself had claimed. So everything goes up. So the base year is very important. So we have to have a complex index number formula, which our people don't have. They do this simple thing of using 1 year's fixed price. So therefore, if you do according to what the UPA used as the base, our growth rate is maybe 4.9,
as low as that. But forget how the calculation, the fact is that the growth rate is low, and what caused it? What are the two reasons that you would say it caused it?
First of all, there has been a decline in investment. We may hide it by saying that your FDI has gone up, etc. Second, the interest rates being raised by this Raghuram Rajan has killed small and medium industries. They are closing down. Third is, because of high interest rates, we have got high NPAs also. And banks are on the verge of collapse. If you ask me how the crisis will come or the depression will come, banks will start folding up maybe in another 6 months. If you ask me what the main rate is, that the people's saving rates had gone down. It was earlier on 36% of the GDP, now it's 29%. The rates of interest being raised during the Raghuram Rajan period and marginally reduced now. That has finished off the small and medium industries, which is 60% of your industrial production. So that they are the key things. There are other things also. The exports have come down, imports have come down. I think that was a miracle, because I've never seen an economy where exports and imports both have come down. And yet in the speech of the finance minister, he says our trade balance has come down. But the trade balance has come down because the imports have come down faster. That's not an achievement. It's actually, it's like a patient dead. His temperature comes down, so you claim, well, I brought the temperature down.
So, Jay, the patient is dead, effectively. Two reasons I was also focusing on was demonetization and the hasty implementation of GST. Hasn't that also added to the gloomy situation?
Let's look at a slightly larger picture. There is no doubt that in the last three quarters, the growth rate numbers have come down. You can see this as a negative, and of course, growth rates coming down should be of concern. But I have a slightly different view, and of the many views out there, my view is best reflected by the World Bank's country head for India, who has said that the GST implementation is a tectonic shift. It is not just one of the routine policy decisions that any government takes. And here on this show earlier, we have discussed, I believe that the GST is the single most economically important decision, policy decision implemented by any government in the last 70 years. It creates a single market for the first time. It totally changes the dynamics of how the Indian economy works. So there was bound to be some blip. Before that, you had demonetization, which international ratings agencies like Moody's and Standard & Poor's, they assessed and said that you should expect at least a couple of quarters of it affecting the economy before it picks up.
Hmm.
There is bound to be short-term difficulty, and this is what we are seeing very clearly. And GST, I agree with you, it's a very complex thing. Now, you can call it hasty, but something which was pending for nearly two decades. In fact, I would say it was pending for five decades. There were people that were wanting it to be stretched out for another year or two or three. So, yes, they have had glitches, and these glitches need to be addressed. There is a clogging of the online reporting system of GST. These need to get sorted out. And I agree with Dr. Swamy when he said that interest rates were too high. There was a formulaic basis which was put in place, which in theory is fine. I don't have a problem with that. But when inflation was already low, there was no point in continuing with high interest rates. That had also affected. So these are issues there. But I see the outcome of this, if they sort out the glitches in GST implementation within the next quarter or two, then in the next couple of years, I see this as having very, very fundamentally positive impact on the economy.
So tailwinds for the tailspin. Mr. Tulsi, he's been making decisions that may be good politically, but very bad economically, you know. I think you'd agree with me on GST and demonetization.
What I want to say is that this government is excellent in propaganda.
I thought that was.
But you can't bully economy. And how long can you mislead the people that economy is flourishing? Demonetization has had no distress. You can keep saying that. But for instance, bank loan, bank accounts, 30 crore bank accounts have been opened. But how many of them were with zero balance? Now, to curb that propaganda, they said deposit 10 rupees each. Now, you give loan waiver to the farmers. You know, these are symbolic things, but people need food. You say that loan waiver, and they are being paid 10 rupees of loan waiver, for which they have to spend 50 rupees to go there. So propaganda has a limit. You can fool some of the people all the time. You can fool all the people some of the time, but you can't fool all people all the time.
So Rajiv, where do you stand in this debate?
No, look, I think I want to just set the politics aside for a minute and try and understand what are the four parts of a growing economy. What are the four components? There is consumption, there is private domestic investment, there is foreign investment, and then there is government investment. This government, since 2014, has been hobbled, we know it, by the fact that both the private investment side and the government investment side has been, in a sense, crippled by the 13 quarters of the UPA's declining capital formation, foreign investment sentiment decline, and investment decline that they inherited. They also inherited in May 14 a completely almost on the brink domestic banking sector. So I understand that people want to score brownie points and, you know, pot shots and so on and so forth. But I don't think the government or the statistics office is anyway denying the fact that the economy in the last three quarters has moderated. But if you go to the reasons why the economy has moderated, it has moderated because private domestic investment is completely shut. From May 2014 and 13 quarters before that, and now exasperated by the fact that the banking sector is now in a full-blown crisis, as Dr. Swamy said, there is really no credit available to domestic firms. More so, the backbone of our economy has always been the MSME sector.
Yes.
That has been completely, in a sense, crippled and denied credit for successive quarters. It is not just in this government. It has started 13 quarters before May 14 and continues. So if you ask me today, in an economy that depends 85% of whose credit comes from the government public sector banking system, which is almost today on its knees, to expect the economy to do well, despite the fact that we have peak flows in foreign direct investment, we have consumption that is continuing to grow significantly, is asking for too much. The second point that Jay mentioned, We are now moving into an era that is of structural reforms. Now, GST and demonetization will have a cost, will have a teething 1-2 quarter. It has been candidly told by the government that there will be sectors of the economy, including parts of the informal economy, that will, in a sense, be impacted by this transition to a single market, by this transition to a less cash economy. I believe, as today has come out from JP Morgan, that 17-18, the coming quarters, are going to see almost a rebound from where we are today. I don't agree with my respected economist colleague, Dr. Swamy, at the risk of him getting very angry at me, that we are going to go into a tailspin or a depression. I think we are at an inflection point. The economy must, from this stage, change its trajectory going positive. This is what my strong belief.
Economy is bottomed out and it will go up. Do you buy that?
Well, this much is admitted that it's in a inflection point. So that means it was that way, but now it's going
to be. You said tailspin.
First of all, don't give me all this Morgan Stanley and Merrill Lynch and JP Morgans and so on. We are the biggest employers of these people. Hmm. Look at the conference that took place in May of this year in Yokohama in Tokyo. You know about this conference? Yeah. It was the conference of all these such agencies which give you Standard and Poor.
Credit rating agencies.
They gave us BBB-. That's one minus below, above
investment
collapse point. Okay. And they were all our, you know, the economic affairs secretary was there. All the finance ministry officials are there. They won't listen. And finally, they made a statement that there's an international conspiracy against us, etc. But the fact is, I don't go by all this. I only simply say, what does their employment data say? Employment, unemployment increasing. Okay. What does your expansion of credit by banks say? The last 10 years average has never been less than 15%. This last 2 years, it's been 5%, 6%. Okay, I've sent all these data to the Prime Minister.
You wrote to the Prime Minister?
Yeah,
also.
I wrote him a 16-page letter with all the graphs, everything. All right, people are not interested in the future. They want to know what you're going to do now. So I have said to the Prime Minister, do something which people feel immediately. One is cutting in the interest rates, bring it down to 9%. There'll be a big change in, and raise the fixed deposit rate to 9% also. All right. To abolish income tax. You see, you want more, I can give you more. I'm an economist, and I'm really pained to see all these business types coming and becoming economists for us, like Raghuram Rajan. They are all microeconomists. Economy is a macro system, where if I do something here, it has an effect there.
Wow. Yeah, so, well, we just want to take a break. I want to come back to you. So either tailspin, or is it just a short-term measure, or is it the government falling in its own propaganda? Stay with us. Welcome back to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable on the economy. Rajiv, before the break, you wanted to comment.
I don't think I'm denying anything you're saying. I think there is a clear acceptance of the fact that private business in India is not investing.
Yeah.
They are not investing, therefore they are not importing. And if they are not importing, they are not exporting.
That's right.
There is no denying that. But the cause for that is the fact that there is no credit available to them.
Why not?
The banking sector today, we know it, for many, many quarters, has been in this loop, vicious loop of...
interruption. Let's not talk about the UPA. That was the worst period possible in the last 70 years, according to me. And we had a complete crook as a finance minister for most part of that.
What's with you and finance ministers?
Well, this present finance, I'm bound by party discipline, not to speak on individuals. Okay. All right. Now, I'm saying that UPA, there's no doubt. If the rot has been set in, yes, I agree with you. UPA has created the base for it. But we came to power. So and we are supposed to give new economic policies. You can't have the same people. Why did you continue with Raghuram Rajan? Why did you continue with Arvind Subramaniam?
No, I didn't continue with either of them. I'm just making the point that I don't think anybody is disputing his facts. I just want to say that if there is anything that you can fault the government with today, is the fact that the public sector banking system issue that they inherited in May 2014 continues to remain unaddressed. Continues to remain unsolved, and therefore the biggest bottleneck to credit flow into Indian industry, which is the banking sector, remains a bottleneck. So, and I'm just explaining why there is a problem that we have today.
It's an inherited problem from the UPA.
The problems of the Indian economy had become fundamental because of being unaddressed for many, many years. You could have taken an approach of tinkering and window dressing and managing, which sad to say, some economists did try to do, present company excluded.
I wasn't allowed.
Or you could have taken an approach which goes to the roots of the problem and changes things. This is the structural reform that we are talking about. Now, do you remember when GST implementation or GST passage by Parliament was getting delayed for months and months and months? One canard started doing the rounds that even the government doesn't want to pass it. They're just passing the buck to the opposition, and they don't want to pass it because it will lead to the economy slowing down and it will have an impact in the next round of elections.
Yes.
I remember talking to members of the government, and they said, no, that's not true, we are keen on passing it, and ultimately it did get passed. But this was an apprehension which was already there. And if you decided to go with a tinkering approach, you wouldn't have had this kind of bitter medicine to swallow. You know, I don't think that implementing GST was a bad thing. I don't think implementing GST within the time frame that they tried
to do it
is a bad thing.
Where is the empirical evidence that GST is causing the slowdown? Where is that coming from?
No, because we have finance ministry officials saying that this could be a effect of the GST.
I don't see any evidence to say that GST.
They are blaming the first GDP figures of the first quarter on the GST stock.
I think there is a school of thought that says that demonetization has had an impact on the informal economy, and that the jury is out on that. But I don't think anybody is talking about GST making an impact on either the index of industrial production or on GDP growth. There is a lot of inconvenience being caused to a lot of small businesses as a result of transiting to a new tax regime. But I haven't read any finding anywhere that GST is directly correlatable to any slowdown in the economy. I don't know if you
said anything.
May I just add something very quickly? You know, one thing that has been just touched upon, I want to go into a little bit more. Let's talk about domestic investment not happening. It's real. This is a real problem. Everybody knows that for several years, and again, this goes beyond the last 3 years, many, many Indian investors, many Indian industrialists have been moving their residences abroad. They've been taking residences in other countries because the situation in India was getting tighter. Now, you could have taken an approach that, look, we need to go soft on this sector, on business people, so that they'll keep investing in India. Or you could have taken a decision that we need to clean up the mess that we have with a large chunk of the economy being informal, being cash-oriented. So yes, if you are going to crack down on cash, if you are going to crack down on tax evaders, linking Aadhaar to PAN cards, for instance, has a lot of people on the run because they used to have multiple PAN cards and not pay taxes. This comes as a shock to those people who have been gaming the system. Now, I think, give it a couple of quarters, they will reconcile to the reality that they have to pay taxes and they have to continue to.
But the government doesn't have too many quarters left.
That's the government's issue. That's a political issue that they have to discuss. But economically, I think this is not, you know, to argue that this is the wrong path, I'm not so convinced.
That could bring in Mr. Tulsi, then we'll have Dr. Swami have the last word.
You see, I find that the government does not acknowledge reality. On 8th November 2016, the Honorable Prime Minister made a statement about demonetization. In that, 18 times he repeated, Kala Dhan, Kala Dhan, Kala Dhan, Kala Dhan lane ke liye ye kiya ja raha hai. And 5 times he said, Jali note. Now, both these were the prime objectives which were delineated by the Honorable Prime Minister.
But he shifted the goalpost later.
And the then Attorney General, Mukul Rohtgi, told the Supreme Court, and that's what is recorded in the media, reported in media, that we expect that more than 10 lakh crore will not come back. And the rest of the money we are going to use for dealing with insurgency in the Northeast and in J&K. See, now when the entire money has come back, can we not say that there is the prime objective of demonetization was defeated, is lost. In fact, it become counterproductive because entire black money also become white.
Yeah, no arguments there. Huh?
And then the second counterfeit, according to the RBI press note, the entire counterfeit currency which has come back is 40 crore. Now, sure. Second objective also goes. Then we say digitization was the real objective. When did Prime Minister talk about digitization? When did the Prime Minister talk about cashless economy?
But digitization is not a bad thing. It's something that we should move towards, right?
No, but we can't change goalposts. We are trying to justify the policy of demonetization, which has utterly failed. Why don't we acknowledge that?
Okay. Well, some of us have acknowledged it. Raji, you want to come in if I go to Dr. Swami?
No, I think again there is a I'm saying this politely, there's a rush to judgment on demonetization, and I don't grudge the opposition to in their enthusiasm to rush to this judgment.
I'm opposition to you,
yeah,
not anywhere.
Yeah, so but I'm not that I'm government either, but I just want to say this. I think the demonetization was thought through with certain assumptions. The belief was that some amount of currency wouldn't come back, but obviously with the jugaad and whatever else that
so it failed.
No, it didn't fail. I don't think we should rush to that judgment because the process of evaluating
for five years.
I think, look, the finance minister has said very clearly the money has made its way back into the banking system. That does not mean that money is white. It continues to be tracked, and the jury is still out on how much money will be tracked, investigated, and found to be illegal, and that process we should allow to continue.
May I add something? The immediate reaction against demonetization was mostly by people in Latians Delhi, because I kept reporting from my constituency that people were very happy with it, and I got a lot of flack for that. They used to argue that it's both politically bad, economically bad. Politically, it was not bad at all. Economically, some people say the jury is out. Let me say this. I think it was wrongly estimated that some money wouldn't come back. I was wrong myself. I myself had thought some of the money wouldn't come back. But agents were there trying to organize things. But remember, one of the things that happened was that the rules were being changed every couple of days. Yes. And that was being criticized. No, that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Because while the people, it was cat and mouse chasing going on. So I think while a lot of jugaad was done to bring the money back into the system, I don't think that money can be accessed again. A lot of that money, I don't think can be accessed again because the rules changed. You could drop it in, but to take it out again, I think it's becoming much more difficult, particularly with the data mining that is going on, particularly with the linking of Aadhaar and with PAN card and with bank accounts. So it's not so simple. My simple question, if you think it did not affect black money, just go and talk to the real estate people, just go and talk
Absolutely.
To the private engineering colleges, then tell me that it didn't affect
Absolutely.
Black money.
But all that has had an impact on the economy. A lot of red flags for you here, Dr. Swami.
No, see, surprisingly, I agree with him. There are discussions.
This is a moment.
There are some good days, yes.
We should not be discussing demonetization and GST.
Okay.
According to me, they are both should have been done differently, okay? But and should have been timed differently. And I must say that before the elections, Modi had appointed a committee called Committee for Strategic Action for Lok Sabha elections. I was the chairman of that. And we recommended it, but we also said the following things the finance ministry has to do, which they didn't do.
Demonetization.
Yeah, you know, there was a lot of mismatch and so. But as a concept, I'm in favor of it. GST also, I believe, is mistimed because you continued the Congress GSTN, which is a private body. I'm shocked, you see, the government money, and that is huge amounts. You see, 7 lakh crores is the tax we're going to collect. We are depositing in a private bank. HDFC and ICICI. before we distributed to the states and center. Now, because our Infosys has collapsed, its program has collapsed. So that money is now in those two private banks who are lending it out for 30 days and 40 days and earning a huge amount of money. And fortunately, the Prime Minister has finally agreed with my thing that CAG will be allowed to inspect this. And so I'm sure that some more corruption cases are coming.
And more roundtables.
Yeah. We are not on that. Issue is, today the public is unhappy, whatever the reason. And so today I want the people to get more jobs. I want them to get loans easily. I want them not to be harassed by taxes. In fact, tax harassment is increased, by the way. So all these done, people immediately feel it. They become with you. Then you explain to them, I have to do some tough decisions, and then do it. But then you have to be an economist for that, because you understand the macro system only if you are an economist. You have to be an educated economist. Most people think economics is just buying and selling. It's not.
Okay.
So the economic system has to be handled very carefully, and I'm sorry it hasn't been handled.
And there is a law, if prices rise, governments can fall. Vajpayee found that out, Narasimha Rao also found it out. If you implement strict reforms, you also have to rush in with some corrective measures. And the Modi government has very little time left to do that. But that's it from us in this roundtable. Thank you for watching this show. We'll see you again same time next week.